ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकय चक्षुषुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स पदान्तिकं। वन्देहं श्रीगुरः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं सागरजातम् सहगना रघुनाथानितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं कृष्णा चैतन्य देवं श्रीराधा कृष्ण पादं सहगना ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितं च नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्ण पृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशधारिणे वंचाकल्पतरूपश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पापनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो महावदन्नाय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम्ने गौरतिष्ये नमः। हे कृष्ण करुणा सिन्धु दीनबंधु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकांत राधाकांत नमस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी विशभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। मुखम करति वाचलम पंगु लंघयति गिरिं यत्कृपा तमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुदिन तारिणां परमानंद माधवं श्री चैतन्येश्वर। हरे कृष्णा। सो वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर द थर्ड डे ऑफ अवर डिस्कशन सीरीज ऑन Krishna Katha on the occasion of Janmashtami, upcoming Janmashtami festival. So last 2 days we discussed about deliverance of Putana. So from today we'll be discussing about how Krishna delivered Kaliya. Putana was killed, but Kaliya was subdued. So, very interesting pastime, and so many things to be learned from this pastime also. So, Krishna, he used to go with his cowherd boys, the cow with cows and calves, to the forest of Vrindavan. And they used to herd the cows, they used to eat, they used to play, and they're enjoying in the forest. One day what happened, the cows, calves, the cowherd boys were very thirsty and they wanted to drink the water. So they came at the bank of the Jamuna river and started drinking the water. As soon as they touched the water of Jamuna, they felt unconscious and left their bodies. Because it was connected with the Kaliya lake. In that way, the pastime begins. It is narrated in the last section of the chapter 15 of the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Then chapter 16 and chapter 17 discuss in detail about the pastimes of delivering Kaliya by Krishna. So when these cowherd boys, they are unconscious, they left their bodies. So Krishna, out of his causeless mercy, glanced over them And when Krishna glanced over these cowherd boys, they all again gained their consciousness and came to their lives. So they got back their life. How it is possible? By the glance of Krishna. So that is the power of the glance of Krishna. Even the dead body can come back into life. And that is the potency of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So we go to the temple to have darshan of the Lord. Whether we have good darshan of the Lord or not, but we should go to the temple so that Krishna can see us. Because if Krishna sees us, that becomes very, very auspicious. Krishna's glance is very, very auspicious in our life. So therefore, it is very, very important as a devotee to go to the temple to have darshan regularly, if possible every day. And if you are not near the temple, then you can at least have darshan of your Lord in the form of small deities or picture at your home. So regular darshan of the Lord is very, very important. That is also part of our devotional service. And by Krishna's glance, those devotees who come in front of the Lord makes their life very auspicious. That's why Prabhupada has introduced Mangal Arati. If we go to Mangal Arati by the glance of the Lord during the morning hours, makes the whole day auspicious. Mangala means auspicious. So Mangal Arati means when you participate in that Arati, the whole day becomes very auspicious. So that's why Prabhupada stressed so much to attend Mangal Arati. So either Mangal Arati or other Arati, taking darshan of the Lord regularly is very, very important. Because by the merciful glance of the Supreme Lord, make our life very auspicious. So here, Krishna not only make the lives of the cowherd boys auspicious, these are the pastimes of Krishna, they are the eternal associates of the Lord. But here, through this pastime, Krishna is showing to the whole world the power of his glance. So by the glance of the Supreme Lord, Krishna, the cowherd boys, those who left their bodies, they are brought back into their lives. And that is the potency. When the cowherd boys gained their consciousness, they understood that because of the poisonous effect, they left their body and now they got back their lives and they are so happy by the wonderful act of Krishna. So in that way, the pastimes of delivering or subduing Kaliya begins. Then chapter 16, Sukadev Goswami starts with a statement, what happened to Kaliya. Sukadev Goswami said, Lord Shri Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, seeing the Jamuna River had been contaminated by the black snake Kaliya, desired to purify the river and thus Lord banished him from it. So whole pastime was spoken in one verse. So there was poison. There was a lot of disturbance in that lake. So Krishna drove away Kaliya and purified Jamuna River. In one verse, Sukadeva Goswami spoke the whole first time. But see the reaction of Parikshit Maharaj. King Parikshit inquired, O learned sage, please explain how the Supreme Personality of Godhead chastise the serpent Kaliya within the unfathomable waters of the Jamuna, and how it was that Kaliya had been living there for so many ages. O Brahmana, The unlimited Supreme Personality of Godhead freely acts according to his own desires. Who could be satiated when hearing the nectar of the magnanimous pastimes he performed as a cowherd boy in Vrindavan? So this is the qualification of a listener. So Parikshit Maharaj did not want to hear the pastime of Krishna in a summary form. He wanted to hear in details. That is the quality of a devotee. A devotee always wants to hear Krishna Katha in details. So therefore, asking question is very, very important. Just like Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita and he completed Bhagavad Gita in the second chapter only. But Arjuna asked question to Krishna, and because of that question, then whole Bhagavad Gita started manifesting. So the quality of the Krishna Katha depends on the quality of the question. So when the sages of Naimisharanya asked question to Suta Goswami in Naimisharanya at the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam, Suta Goswami was so happy with the questions because that was related to Krishna, Krishna Katha. So any question which is related to Krishna is very, very glorious. Why? Any topic about Krishna is auspicious, beneficial to the speaker, to the hearer, and to those who are asking questions. So therefore, when we ask question to the spiritual master or any senior Vaishnava, we should ask the questions which are related to Krishna consciousness, which are related to Krishna or his devotees. So in that way, the things will become auspicious. So here, Parikshit Maharaj was not happy to hear the statement of Sukadeva Goswami telling the whole pastime in one verse. He wanted to hear in details. And that's why he asked the question that how come Kaliya was there. He started asking question in such a way that the pastime will unfold. So that is the way. So then Sukadeva Goswami started speaking. So Sukadeva Goswami said, within the river Kalindi, Jamuna, was a lake inhabited by serpent Kaliya, whose fiery poison constantly heated and boiled its waters. And indeed, the vapors thus created were so poisonous that the birds flying over the contaminated lake would fall down into it. So, the Kaliya lake was not in the main flow of the Jamuna river. Our acharyas are explaining, if the poison was there in the main flow of Jamuna river, then all the places in Mathura and other places also could have the same poisonous effect. But it did not happen. It only happened into that area of Kaliya lake. So Kaliya lake was a branch coming out from the Jamuna river, and it's a huge lake. And in that lake, Kaliya serpent used to stay there. And it was very poisonous. And vapor used to come out from that lake. And if the birds were flying above that lake, the bird used to fall into the water of that lake and dead. That was the poisonous effect of that lake. It was dangerously poisonous. And also the vapor, and it was also spreading nearby, and all the trees and all other elements, they are also dead. Everything was dead nearby. And whoever used to come above the lake, they are also dead. All the trees and plants, they are all surrounding that lake were dead because of the poisonous effect of that water. Nobody could go nearby that lake because there are serpents there in the hole. So it was all dangerously arranged. And who was the king, who was the master of that place? The serpent Kaliya. So this is the result of the poison. But one tree was not affected, the Kadamba tree. One Kadamba tree was there at the bank of that Kaliya lake, was unaffected. Why? There is a big story, but Garuda was carrying a nectar pot. And while Garuda was carrying that nectar pot, one drop of nectar fell on that tree. And because of that nectar, that tree became immortal. And therefore, the poisonous effect of that lake could not harm that tree. And that was also the desire of Krishna, because Krishna wanted to engage that Kadamba tree in the service of him. Because Krishna, we'll see later on that Krishna will jump into the water from that Kadamba tree only. So therefore, except that Kadamba tree, everything was dead surrounding that lake. And Kaliya represents envy. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that Krishna killed different demons in Vrindavan. And we should not take it that, oh, it is a wonderful pastime. There are some demons, Krishna killed them. So nice, Krishna is so powerful. But how it relates to us? So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that each and every demon represents one of the anarthas in our heart as a practicing devotee. So practicing devotees are those devotees, those who are practicing Krishna consciousness, but they have anarthas in their heart. Anartha means unwanted elements, unwanted desires in our heart, which has no meaning in our spiritual journey. Artha means which has value. Anartha means which does not have any value. So it is called anartha because these things have no value in our spiritual journey. There are many varieties of anarthas in our heart. And lust, anger, greed, pride, envy, illusion, ego, so many things are there in our heart. And that make our heart polluted, like a poison. So envy is one of those anarthas. And Kaliya represents that envy. And Krishna entered into the lake and subdued Kaliya. In the same way, if we allow Krishna to enter in our heart, which is like the Kaliya lake, then what will happen? The poison in that lake of our heart will be subdued. All the anarthas in our heart will be destroyed. And that is the purpose of Krishna's advent. That is the purpose of Krishna's pastime of subduing Kaliya. So Krishna is showing that Kaliya was delivered. In the same way, any devotee, any practicing devotee who is sincere, to be delivered by Krishna, then he has to allow Krishna to enter in our heart. So how Krishna will be entering into our heart? Krishna can enter in our heart through hearing Krishna Katha. So therefore, hearing Krishna Katha is very, very important. And we should hear from a realized devotee. We should hear from a realized soul. So hearing is more important than speaking. That's why Krishna has given us two ears and one mouth. And ear, both the ears are open and mouth is supposed to be closed. But in the modern society, you are very busy in talking and we have very less time in hearing. But Krishna consciousness, spiritual journey begins with hearing. So when you hear Krishna Katha, then our heart gets the opportunity to be cleansed. Because we cannot cleanse our heart without any other with any other means. Because it's inside. We can clean the gross things with so many other materials. But our heart can be cleansed only by Krishna Katha. Krishna's name, Krishna's glories, Krishna's pastime. When that enters into our heart, then our heart gets cleansed. But we have to hear from a realized person, from a bona fide source. And when a pure devotee speaks, he speaks from his heart, not from his intellect. And when that pure devotee speaks, that sound vibration carries the aroma of the dust of the lotus feet of Krishna. Because in the heart of a pure devotee, Krishna resides. And when that sound vibration is vibrated from the lotus mouth of that pure devotee, that carries the aroma of the dust of the lotus feet. And that's why that sound vibration is very, very powerful. And when that sound vibration enters into the heart of an attentive listener, a sincere listener, a faithful listener, then Krishna is transferred from the heart of that speaker to the heart of that sincere listener. And that is the effect of hearing. And in that way, Krishna can enter into our heart. So Krishna jumped from the Kadamba tree and entered into the Kaliya lake. The same way Krishna can enter into our heart if we hear with rapt attention, if we hear with faith, if we hear with a lot of attention, then Krishna can enter into our heart. And he can purify our heart by his divine presence. So when Krishna entered, how he entered? Lord Krishna saw how the Kaliya serpent had polluted the Jamuna river with his terribly powerful poison. Since Krishna had descended from the spiritual world, specifically to subdue envious demons, the Lord immediately climbed to the top of a very high Kadamba tree and prepared himself for battle. He tightened his belt, slapped his arms, and then jumped into the poisonous water. So Krishna loves adventure because we get happiness by adventure. So people jump into the water for sports. So Krishna also loves that kind of sport. So that tendency, whatever we have, all come from Krishna. So now Krishna is not fearful about the whole condition. Because Krishna is fearless. Fear cannot touch Krishna. Because Krishna is beyond material modes. So he is taking this opportunity, turn this difficult situation and make that difficult situation into a wonderful pastime. And he jumped into the poisonous water. And what happens when Krishna enters into that lake? When the Supreme Personality of Godhead landed in the serpent's lake, the snakes there became extremely agitated and began breathing heavily, further polluting it with volumes of poison. The force of the Lord's entrance into the lake caused it to overflow on all sides. Poisonous, fearsome waves flooded the surrounding lands up to a distance of 100 bow lengths. This is not at all amazing. However, for the Supreme Lord possesses infinite strength. So Krishna was very little, was a small child, 3 years old. And he entered into the lake. And water started overflowing in all directions from the lake. How it is possible? A small boy, if he enters into that in a water reservoir, it can happen like that? No. It has to be a very big thing. Then water can overflow. And the lake was a very big lake. I think it's around 8 miles area. It's a huge lake. And as soon as Krishna entered into that lake, water started overflowing. So by this, we can understand Krishna was not a ordinary, was not an ordinary boy. He was the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who has tremendous amount of power. And because of that quality of Krishna, because Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is all-powerful, and because of Krishna's presence in that water, and that power is shown by the overflow of the water in different direction. So Krishna is establishing his supremacy as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Then what he is doing? Krishna began sporting in Kaliya's lake like a lordly elephant. Although he was a small child, example is given that he was like a lordly elephant. Elephant is huge. So when elephant entered into water, it overflows. But although Krishna was a small boy, but he was acting like an elephant, swirling his mighty arms and making the water resound in various ways. When Kaliya heard these sounds, he understood that someone was trespassing in his lake. The serpent could not tolerate this and immediately came forward. This is a symptom of a person having demoniac quality. It is called territorial problem. We always think this is my area. This is my jurisdiction. It happens. And that is the cause of the fight in this world. Why? Because we want to lord it over. We think we are the owner. We are the proprietor. This area belongs to me. And nobody can enter into that area. I am the owner. And people file cases. People go on fighting. People go for war to claim that ownership. And that is the nature of this world. And the serpent, Kaliya, was demonstrating the same quality. He thought that this place belongs to me. How come without my permission somebody has entered into my lake? And he was a little astonished also. Generally, nobody can go near that lake because it was so poisonous. But Krishna not only entered into the lake, he was enjoying that lake and he was playing in that lake and making beautiful sound, wonderful sound in that lake. It's like a musical performance by Krishna because he was playing, enjoying in that lake. But Kaliya could not tolerate it. So we cannot see the happiness of others if our heart is filled with envy. If someone is happy, we don't become happy. We become disturbed. Just like Kaliya, he should have been happy that a small boy is happily playing in his lake. He should have been happy, but he was totally disturbed. Why? Because first he thought that he entered into my territory, He entered into my area without my permission, and nobody could enter into my area. How come he could have entered in my area? And not only entered into my area, he is happily playing in my area. Why is he happy? And people always think like that. Why he is happy? I am working so hard. I am doing so many things. I have achieved so many things, but I am not happy. But he is happy. Why? That is the problem. We don't feel happy by seeing others happy. And why we feel like that? Because we have the problem of envy in our heart. So happiness is an experience, and that experience is coming when heart is pure. So in this world, we are not happy what we have, rather we are unhappy what we don't have. That is the problem. So therefore, happiness comes from within. Happiness is an experience of the heart. Happiness is the experience of the soul. So therefore, we have to be free from these problems of our heart. So envy is that problem. It's a very deep-rooted problem. And Kaliya represents that quality. So Krishna is showing us how we can be free from that, that quality in our heart. Then Kaliya saw that Krishna, who wore yellow silken garments, was very delicate. His attractive body shining like a glowing white cloud. His chest bearing the mark of a Srivatsa, his face smiling beautifully, and his feet resembling the whorl of a lotus flower. The Lord was playing fearlessly in the water. Despite his wonderful appearance, the envious Kaliya furiously beat him on the chest and then completely enwrapped him in his coils. So Kaliya could not tolerate Krishna's presence. Kaliya could not tolerate the happiness of Krishna. And what he did? Although Krishna was so beautiful, Krishna is really beautiful. But he could not appreciate the beauty. Why? Because he was envious. So Krishna is the most beautiful person in this world. How much we can understand that is very difficult to understand. How we can understand the beauty of Krishna? He's unlimited. So therefore, his beauty is also unlimited. But we can get a glimpse of that from the explanation given by our acharyas. It is said there are different levels of beauty because there are different levels of existence. We are in the Bhuloka, earthly planet. Above us are Sargoloka, heavenly planets. Beyond the material world, there are Vaikuntha planets. And top of the Vaikuntha planets are Dwarka, and beyond Dwarka is Vrindavan. There are different levels of existence. So it is said the most beautiful woman, most beautiful lady is known as Miss Universe, Miss World, like that. Most beautiful. But the beauty of the observers in the heavenly planet is much more superior than the beauty of this earthly planet. Much more beautiful there. The observers in the heavenly planet, they are much more beautiful than the Lakshmis of Vaikuntha planet. They are much more beautiful than the officers of heavenly planets. Then the queens of Dwarka are much more beautiful than the Lakshmis of Vaikuntha planet. The gopis of Vrindavan are more beautiful, much more beautiful than the queens of Dwarka. And there are so many gopis in Vrindavan. And out of these gopis, 108 gopis are the most beautiful gopis, and out of 108 are most beautiful gopis, and out of 8, 2 are most beautiful gopis, and out of the 2, Radharani and Chandravali are the most beautiful gopis, and out of these 2, Radharani is most beautiful gopi. And Radharani is attracted to the beauty of Krishna. One day one gopi came and told Radharani that, Radharani, I saw the beautiful form of Krishna today. So Radharani told, you are so fortunate, I don't have that fortune. She said, why? Because when I look at a particular limb of Krishna, I cannot move my eyes from that limb of Krishna. So how can I see the beautiful form of Krishna? Krishna is so beautiful. So the most beautiful lady is attracted by the beauty of Krishna. Srimati Radharani is attracted by Krishna's beauty. But to talk about Radharani, Krishna himself is attracted by his beauty. He's so beautiful. So therefore, we have to appreciate the beauty of Krishna. And when we appreciate the beauty of Krishna and get attracted to his beauty, then attraction for the beauty of this world will slowly, slowly diminish. And we can get free from the material bondage, and we can go to the spiritual world. So therefore, Krishna shows his beauty in this world so that we can become attracted to his beauty. But here, Kaliya, because of the envy, he was not able to appreciate the beauty of Krishna. Why? Because he was envious. So if we are envious, then we cannot appreciate the beauty of Krishna. We cannot appreciate the good qualities of others. So therefore, in order to appreciate Krishna consciousness, in order to appreciate Krishna's beauty, in order to appreciate Krishna's pastime, we have to be free from envy. That's why Srimad Bhagavatam says that Dinmat Saranam Satam. If we really want to understand Srimad Bhagavatam, if we really want to realize Srimad Bhagavatam, what we have to do? We have to give up envy. That is very, very important. If we have envy in our heart, we cannot appreciate others. So to talk about appreciating Krishna, not possible. So dealing with envy is very, very important part of our sadhana bhakti. So through this pastime, Krishna is showing the way by which we can be free from this envy. Then that was the effect of Kaliya. Kaliya, what he did? He furiously beat him on the chest and he enwrapped him in his coils. Because Kaliya was having so many hoods. It's not an ordinary. He was not an ordinary snake. He was extraordinary snake. Dangerously poisonous. So, and he has a very dangerous coil, and Krishna was entrapped in that coil. So this is all happening because of the desire of Krishna. How Kaliya can entrap Krishna? Not possible. But Krishna is doing it by his own sweet will to purify Kaliya. Just like Putana was embraced by Krishna. But here, Kaliya is embracing Krishna. But Krishna embraced Putana and Putana got purified. And here, Kaliya is embracing Krishna. So the lesson to be learned, whether our intention is good or bad, when we are in touch with Krishna, we become purified. So you already heard in detail how Putana got purified, although he had the desire to kill Krishna, but he was purified. Why? Because Putana came in touch with Krishna. Here also, Kaliya is full of envy, is dangerously poisonous, but he is getting purified. How? Because he came in contact with Krishna. That is the merciful nature of Krishna. By this pastime, what is happening? Krishna is going to protect the devotees, and he is also going to protect Kaliya. So he is purifying the demons, and also he is delivering the devotees. So in that way, through this pastime, both the devotees and demons are getting the mercy of Krishna simultaneously. And that shows the magnanimous nature of Krishna. So Kaliya embraced Krishna and wrapped him in his coils. And what is the reaction of the devotees of Krishna? When the members of the cowherd community who had accepted Krishna as their dearmost friend saw him enveloped in the snake's coils, motionless, they were greatly disturbed. They had offered Krishna everything, their very selves, their families, their wealth, wives, and all places. At the sight of the Lord in the clutches of Kaliya's snake, their intelligence became deranged by grief, lamentation, and fear, and thus they fell to the ground. So that is the reaction of the devotees, the cowherd boys, both elderly and also the young cowherd boys. What happened to them? They were feeling grief, lamentation, and fear. This is not mundane fear, lamentation. This is spiritual. Because fear cannot enter into Vrindavan. Because fear is the element of material world. Vrindavan is spiritual. So how fear can enter into Vrindavan? It cannot. But here we are seeing that the devotees, the cowherd boys, they were feeling that. They are feeling grief, lamentation, fear, and they fell to the ground unconscious. Because Krishna wanted to intensify the love of his devotees. Because when the beloved is in difficulty, by seeing that, the intensity of the love of the lover increases. So Krishna wanted to intensify the love of the Brajavasis. He wanted to intensify the love of the devotees of Vrindavan. That's why he is performing this pastime, giving them anxiety, fear, lamentation, grief. But these are all spiritual and is all done by the desire of the Supreme Personality of Godhead through his Yogamaya potency. It's not material thing, it's spiritual. Then, what's happening with the cows, bulls, and female calves? The cows, bulls, and female calves, in great distress, called out piteously to Krishna. Fixing their eyes on him, they stood still in fear, as if ready to cry, but too shocked to shed tears. That is Vrindavan. In Vrindavan, not only the humans, the animals, the cows, bulls, calves, they are also feeling great distress because they love Krishna. They are fully surrendered to Krishna. They have given everything for Krishna. That is the meaning of surrender. Surrender means we have to accept that everything belongs to Krishna. And therefore, everything should be engaged in his service. That is a symptom of bhakti. Whatever we have in our position, we should realize that it belongs to Krishna and offer it to Krishna. You may say, how, if it belongs to Krishna, how we can offer to him? It's already Krishna's. That's the way people try to escape. Offering things to Krishna. He said, anyway, everything belongs to Krishna. How can I offer to Krishna? But we can. Just like this example is given, we go to the Ganges River and we offer puja to Ganges River by offering Ganges water only. So that is the way. Just like a child, a son, small son, if he gives something by buying something from the money of his father and gives that gift to the father, father will not be happy. Father will not say, oh, it's my money, you spend my money to give the gift. But father will be happy, not because the money was spent from his pocket. He'll be happy because this offer of gift was given out of love. Krishna does not want anything from us because everything belongs to him only. He only wants our love. So these devotees of Vrindavan, they have offered everything to Krishna out of love. That's why Krishna is sold out to them. So when we offer everything to Krishna, then Krishna also offers him back completely to us. That is a reciprocation. So we have to be intelligent enough. But we go to Krishna and we ask for some material benediction. My dear Lord, please give this. My dear Lord, please give this. My dear Lord, please give that. This is not intelligence. You have to know what you should ask. So Mahaprabhu teaches us that what we should ask. Mahaprabhu said that we have to ask only pure devotional service to Krishna, nothing else. Na dhanam na janam na sundarim kavitang bajagadish kamaye mamo janmani janmani sare bhavatat bhakti rahitukite. So Mahaprabhu teaches us that we should only pray that we should have unconditional love for him life after life. That is the blessings we should ask for. But generally we have a tendency to ask something material from the Supreme Lord also. That is not a good thing to do in our life, because that is not a symptom of real intelligent person. I narrate a story of three friends going to a king. So the first friend, when he met the king, king asked, what do you want? So the first friend said that, my dear king, my house is in a bad shape. Please build me a very wonderful house for me. So the king called the minister and told the minister, please build a good house for this person. So first friend was so happy. Then second friend was called. Then the king asked, what do you want? Then second friend said that my house is okay, but the road access is not good. So make a good road so that I can go to my house nicely. So king called the minister, said, please build a good road for this person so that he can go to his house without any difficulty. So second friend was so happy. Now road will be built. Now the third friend was called. Then king asked, what do you want? The third friend said, I don't want anything. No, you came to me. You have come to me. So you have to ask something from me. I want to give you something. He said, no, I don't want anything. The king was pushing, he was refusing. But at the end he said, okay, you are pushing me so much to ask something. So I am requesting you, please stay in my house. That's my request to you. If you really want to give something to me, please stay in my house. Then king called the minister. Other two friends were shocked to hear this. But how come instead of asking something, he's inviting the king? He doesn't know what to ask. Then king called the minister and told the minister that I want to stay in his house, make all the arrangements. So where king will stay? A palace has been built. Because king stays in the palace. So one palace has been built. So how king will go? Royal road has been built. All the places have been developed. So whole area has been developed. So who is intelligent? Those who ask for the house, those who ask for the road, that is not real intelligence. But the third friend said, oh, I don't want anything, my dear king, I want only you. In the same way, an intelligent devotee will ask to the Lord, my dear Lord, we don't want anything, I just want you. And that is the mood of Vrindavan. Devotees of Vrindavan, they only want Krishna. Nothing else. Their only business is to serve Krishna and make Krishna happy. That is Vrindavan. The center of life is Krishna. Then what is happening with the other devotees? Because it's happening at the bank of Kalia Lake. But there are so many devotees in their own villages. What's happening to them? In the Vrindavan area, there then arose all three types of fearful omens. Those on the earth, those in the sky, and those in the bodies of living creatures, which announced imminent danger. So Krishna, by his arrangement, has created some omens, ill omens, fearful omens. Three kinds of omens. And it is explained that three kinds of omens are as follows. On the earth, there were disturbing tremors. In the sky, there were meteors falling. And in the bodies of the creatures, there was shivering. And as well as the quivering of the left eye and other parts of the body, these omens announce imminent danger. So you all know, for the man, if the left side, it quivers, it's inauspicious. For the ladies, if the right side quivers, it's inauspicious. There are some inauspicious signs or omens by which we can understand that some inauspicious, dangerous things are going to happen. And when Krishna was bound by the coil of Kalia snake, all inauspicious omens were visible. And seeing the inauspicious omens, Nanda Maharaj and the other cowherd men were fearful. For they knew that Krishna had gone to herd the cows that day without his elder brother Balaram. Because they had dedicated their minds to Krishna, accepting him as their very life, they are unaware of his great power and opulence. Thus, they concluded that inauspicious omens indicated he had met with death, and they were overwhelmed with grief, lamentation, and fear. All the inhabitants of Vrindavan, including the children, women, and elderly person, thought of Krishna just as a cow thinks of her helpless young calf. And thus these poor suffering people rushed out of the village and intent upon finding him. So this is the difference. If there is some danger, we feel that there will be some danger. What do you think? Oh, how I will be affected? We always think about ourselves. Oh, maybe my business will be going through trouble. Maybe my family members will be in trouble. There will be some disturbance in my family. In this way, we always think, what will happen to us? That is the nature of this world. What do you think? It is dangerous? Dangerous means what will happen to me? But here, the Brajavasi, they are not thinking about themselves. What they are thinking that Krishna is in danger. That's why they are known as Krishna conscious. They are the best devotees. What is Vrindavan? Vrindavan is those who are the toppers of different rasas. Topmost devotees. Why Vrindavan is best? Because the devotees of Vrindavan are the best. Whether the devotees in conjugal love, whether the devotees in parental love, whether devotees are in their friendship or in neutrality or in servitorship, they're the topmost devotees. Devotees of Vrindavan are topmost. That's why Vrindavan is topmost. Why they are topmost? Because their focus and attention is only towards Krishna. They always think of Krishna, nothing else. They always think of the welfare of Krishna, something or nothing else. But we, the living entities, the conditioned souls in this world, we always think about our own welfare and think how we'll be happy. But what is the meaning of Krishna consciousness? Meaning of Krishna consciousness is that how Krishna will be happy. That is Krishna consciousness. Whatever the devotees of Vrindavan they do, think, they always think of the welfare of Krishna. Krishna is the center of their life. But in this world, I am the center of our life. How I means I will be happy. How I'll get the benefit. What is there in it? Always thinking about I, and I. That is the symptom of ego. And because of that, we are not happy. Because unless Krishna is happy, we cannot be happy. Because Krishna is the source of happiness. So why devotees of Vrindavan, they are so happy? Because they are connected with Krishna. Because Krishna is happy by their services, by their attitude, by their activities. And because Krishna is happy, that's why they are also happy. That is the secret of Krishna consciousness. So here, by seeing the bad omens, they are thinking about Krishna. And they started developing different kinds of fear. Maybe Krishna has been killed, Krishna is dead. What's going to happen? They are in big anxiety about the welfare of Krishna. And they started running towards the Kaliya lake. But one person was not bothered at all. The Supreme Lord Balaram, the master of all transcendental knowledge, smiled and said nothing when he saw the residents of Vrindavan in such distress, since he understood the extraordinary power of his younger brother. Because Balaram knew very well that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So what will happen to him? Nothing is going to happen. He was confident. And why he was smiling? So Balaram is a source of Ananta Shesh. All the snakes manifested from Ananta Shesh. So Balaram started thinking that Krishna doesn't play with me in the form of Ananta Shesh. Why he has to play with such ordinary snake like Kaliya? And by thinking that, Balaram was smiling. And he was also smiling. Why? Because he knew that nothing is going to happen. And why these devotees of Vrindavan, although Balaram knew they are doing it out of affection for Krishna, but Balaram thought nothing is going to happen to Krishna because Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God, and to kill Kaliya is nothing for him. But Krishna is on a mission because he wanted to deliver Kaliya. He wanted to purify Kaliya because that is the magnanimous nature of Krishna. So Krishna is doing this activity to purify Kaliya and to deliver Kaliya because Krishna has descended in this material world to deliver all of us. So he wanted to deliver Kaliya, and because of that he is arranging this pastime. So how the residents of Vrindavan, they are going towards Kaliya. They followed the footprints of Lord Krishna. The footprints of Lord Krishna, the master of entire cowherd community, were marked with the lotus flower, barleycorn, elephant goat, thunderbolt and flag. My dear King Parikshit, seeing his footprints on the path among the cow's hoofprints, the residents of Vrindavan rushed along in great haste. How they are going? They are following the footprints of Krishna. So in Vrindavan, Krishna's footprints are always there, and nobody walk over the footprint of Krishna. That is the culture of Vrindavan. They worship the footprint of Krishna. In the same way, we should also worship the footprint of Krishna. We should worship the lotus feet of Krishna. And when we worship the lotus feet of Krishna, when we worship the foot, the marks of the lotus feet of Krishna, then definitely we'll reach him. So Brajavasis, they could reach Krishna. Why? They are following in the footsteps of Krishna. So bhakti means following in the footsteps of Krishna. And how we can follow in the footsteps of Krishna? By following in the footsteps of the previous acharyas. How we can follow in the footsteps of previous acharyas? By following in the footsteps of the spiritual masters. That is the process. Bhakti means following in the footsteps. Follow. Follow whom? Follow Krishna. How you can follow Krishna? By following his representatives. So bhakti means following in the footsteps of the pure devotees of the Lord. Following in the footsteps of Krishna. Here, Vajavasis are following the footsteps of Krishna. And in that process, he reached at the bank of Kaliya Lake. As they hurried along the path to the bank of the Jamuna River, they saw from a distance that Krishna was in a lake, motionless within the coils of the black serpent. They further saw that the cowherd boys had fallen unconscious and that the animals were standing on all sides, crying out for Krishna. Seeing all this, the residents of Vrindavan were overwhelmed with anguish and confusion. When the young gopis, whose minds were constantly attached to Krishna, the unlimited Supreme Lord, saw that he was now within the grips of the serpent, then remembered his loving friendship, his smiling glances, and his talks with them, burning with great sorrow, they saw the entire universe as void. Although the elder gopis were feeling just as much as distress as she and were pouring forth a flood of sorrowful tears, they had to forcibly hold back Krishna's mother, whose consciousness was totally absorbed in her son. Standing like corpses with their eyes fixed upon his face, these gopis each took turns recounting the pastimes of the darling of Braja. Lord Balaram then saw that Nanda Maharaj and the other cowherd men who had dedicated their very lives to Krishna were beginning to enter the serpent's lake. As the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Balaram fully knew Lord Krishna's actual power and therefore he restrained them. So Nanda Maharaj and all the senior cowherd men, they wanted to enter into the Kaliya lake to protect Krishna. But Balaram stopped them because Balaram knew very well that Krishna does not need anyone to subdue Kaliya. And if the Brajavasis enter into the water of Kaliya lake, they will have also problem. And because of that, Balaram restricted them. He did not allow anybody to enter into the water of Kaliya lake. And in that way, Balaram was serving as the representative of Krishna and protecting all the Brajavasis, and also was helping Krishna to perform his wonderful pastimes of subduing Kaliya. And what happens after this? Devotees are in anxiety. Some of them are unconscious. Some of them are stunned. Some of them are in grief and lamentation. What Krishna does, that will be discussed tomorrow. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.